and submit their questions via the Q&A box. And when submitting questions, please include information about whom the question is addressed to. And this event will also be recorded for later uploading to our website and social media accounts. And during the webinar, you may interact with us on Twitter using the hashtag WebinarJPALSEA. And don't forget to mention us at @GPAL_SEA. And for any inquiries, please contact Farah at famalia@povertyactionlab.org. Well, good morning, everyone. Good afternoon and good evening, ladies and gentlemen, from wherever you are around the world. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Ade Sabrina Nasution, and before we start the event, please allow me to guide you through today's webinar. First of all, on behalf of organizers, I would like to say welcome. Welcome to JPAL Southeast Asia's webinar with the theme Reshaping Gender Attitudes to Promote Gender Equality and Women Empowerment. What can we learn from evidence? Today's webinar is brought to you by the Abdul Latif Jamil Poverty Action Lab Southeast Asia, or JPAL SEA, in collaboration with Forum Kajian Pembangunan FKP. And JPAL SEA is hosted by Institute for Economic and Social Research, or LPEM FEBUI, at the University of Indonesia, with the support from the Government of Australia. And for the next 1 hour and 15 minutes, we'll be discussing Indonesia's policy and strategies in supporting gender awareness, gender equality, gender norms, its challenge, and share lessons from existing rigorous evidence around the world. And this event will be divided into 4 segments. First, before we start, we will hear the opening remarks from Ibu Jennifer Donohoe, Acting Counselor, Development Effectiveness and Sustainability Section. And this will be followed by a panel discussion with Seema Jayachandran, Professor of Economics from Northwestern University and the JPAL Chair in Gender Sector, and Dr. Randa Leni Rosali, the Deputy of Gender Equality of the Ministry of Women Empowerment and Child Protection of the Republic of Indonesia. We will have a Q&A session at the end of the talk show, and before closing the event with remarks from Ibu Liuna Marliani, the Executive Director of JPAL SEA. Before proceeding further, I would like to apologize that due to urgent engagement this morning, Her Excellency I Gusti Ayu Bintang, the Minister of Women Empowerment and Child Protection of the Republic of Indonesia, is not able to attend. I know we were all very excited to hear from her today, so we are very sorry for this change. We do hope in the future we will have the opportunity to have this discussion with Her Excellency Ibu I Gusti Ayu Bintang. Now, without further ado, we invite Ibu Jennifer Donohoe to deliver the opening remarks.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I was going to say, but then I realized that we have people in a number of different time zones. So welcome to everyone, wherever you are. Thanks very much for inviting me to provide introductory remarks on behalf of the Australian Embassy today. Firstly, I wanted to thank the Indonesian Ministry of Women's Empowerment and Child Protection. The Australian Embassy is delighted to have such a good relationship with your ministry. We're really looking forward to continuing and strengthening that collaboration. I also wanted to thank our hosts from JPAL, to Professor Seema and Ibu Lina, who turns out is a friend of mine from way back. It's lovely to cross paths with you again. And thank you, of course, to all of the organisers today. We really appreciate all the effort that goes into these sessions. So from us at the Australian Embassy, I think we wanted to convey, you know, a few points, talk a little bit about, you know, the perspectives we have in terms of gender equality, where we're coming from. But firstly, I just wanted to sort of start by saying, look, it goes without saying that this COVID pandemic has impacted on all aspects of all of our lives, the way we live, the way we work, how we interact with each other. And I think For some people, these changes have been relatively minor, but you know, for others, this pandemic has had a really substantial impact. And there's a range of factors, including gender, age, disability, and others that have affected how people have been impacted by the pandemic. We've seen that people have experienced job loss, health impacts, and of course, in too many cases, the loss of loved ones. You know, and the loss of loved ones has been a really terrible thing in and of itself, but what we're seeing is for poorer, vulnerable families, this can also mean the loss of a breadwinner, or the loss of a really important carer in a family, and that's in turn exacerbating the poverty cycle. So where, you know, there are great concerns that this pandemic could have raised many of the development gains we've achieved in recent decades. And I'm not going to preempt too much the presentations that'll follow this, but I think, you know, suffice to say that the evidence showing that the pandemic has really increased inequality, more women and girls are falling into poverty, and it's also leading to an increase in violence against women and people with a disability. And the double burden of work and care responsibilities for many women has increased significantly. And these impacts are going to take all of our efforts to address. Now, I think, you know, it's encouraging to see gender equality and women's empowerment are becoming mainstream issues for policymakers and for the public. And we really need to harness that momentum and ensure that the policies and programs are based on solid evidence of the likely benefits and impacts for all people, including women, men, old people, young people, people with a disability, and any other group who might face a barrier to inclusion. From the Australian Embassy side, so, you know, like Indonesia, Australia is very committed to minimising the impacts of this crisis on vulnerable groups. We've committed to both targeted action for women and girls and also to mainstreaming gender disability and social inclusion across all of our partnerships. We're supporting women's economic participation as employees, entrepreneurs. We're also aiming to try to improve gender equality, women's empowerment, disability rights, and social inclusion. And of course, the topic today, you know, we're very committed to supporting the evidence base for policy and program development. It's a really key aspect of our COVID-19 development response, because we think without knowing how the pandemic is impacting on different people and communities, we don't know how to find the right solutions to address those impacts. The Australian government has supported JPAL for some time now, and we really appreciate the work that JPAL does to provide evidence that will improve the effectiveness of things like the social protection programs, in monitoring the economic impacts on employment, food security, migration, and, you know, the uptake of government assistance programs, as well as supporting the Indonesian government to share information on COVID-19 and their prevention measures. We really hope that these contributions will have a meaningful impact in terms of reducing the negative outcomes of the pandemic on vulnerable people. I think today I'm really interested in hearing about the evidence that you have uncovered. I think it'll undoubtedly assist greatly in promoting gender equality and women's empowerment. I want to thank in advance the contributors and participants in the webinar today, and thank you for this opportunity to learn from your experience. I have to admit, I also have another meeting coming up, so I won't be able to stay for the whole session, but I understand there'll be a recording available afterwards, and I'm looking forward very much to hearing that and to hearing all of your perspectives. Jadi, kalau begitu, terima kasih dan selamat berdiskusi semua.
Well, Ibu Jennifer Donohoe, thank you very much for the warm opening remarks as a start to our webinar. We're grateful to have you here. Truly agree that COVID-19 raised so much great concerns where pandemics really increase inequality, double care for works for mothers, and also, of course, childcare significantly. And on behalf of the committee, we would like to thank you for your support towards gender inclusivity with evidence-based programs to tackle gender inequality, especially in even more challenging times like pandemics of COVID-19, but even more to vulnerable parts of the society. We are deeply grateful for your attendance this evening, and we hope you will enjoy the event, Ibu. And now, without further ado, let us invite our first speaker of the day, Professor Seema Jayachandran. By way of introduction, Seema Jayachandran is a professor of economics at Northwestern University. Her research focuses on economic issues in developing countries, including environmental conservation, gender equality, labor markets, health, and education. Seema currently serves on GPAL's board of directors and is the chair of GPAL's gender sector. She is co-editor for the American Economic Journal of Applied Economics, associate editor for the Quarterly Journal of Economics, and co-director of the National Bureau of Economic Research Program in Development Economics. Hello, Seema. Great to have you here. Seema, how are you?
Great. Thank you so much for that introduction. And thank you, Jennifer, for the opening remarks. It's great to be participating in this webinar.
We are really grateful to have you here. Heard so many great things about you. And I'm very excited to chat with you for the next around 30 minutes about gender awareness, gender inclusivity, and gender norms, especially in Indonesia, and, you know, evidence-based research from other countries. So without further ado, Seema, my first question is the most fundamental one, is on the role of laws and institutions in shaping gender norms. So we all know that structural constraints from legal restrictions, customary practices, institutional arrangements are all contributing to the long-held social norms on gender and continue to disadvantage women and girls. And we all know that changing gender norms is difficult if not accompanied by supportive regulatory framework and commitments from formal and informal institutions. My question is, how do you see attempts to use law and policy as tools in changing perceived gender roles? And are there any suggestions for how we can create a national ecosystem that supports women and empowerment? And we talk about ecosystem, that means formal and informally. Please, Seema.
Yeah, that's a great and important question. And I should say from the outset that, you know, I'm not a expert on Indonesia specifically. So I'm a, you know, work on gender in many low and middle income countries. And a lot of the evidence that I know best is I'm going to draw from India, but and try to, you know, talk about things that are relevant for Indonesia. But it's just a really important question. What is the role of governments and policy to try to bring up women and girls? Because it's partly informal norms, you know, what people feel in their hearts or in communities, but a lot of the institutions, as you said, you know, informal institutions, but also formal institutions can play into that. So I think there's a really big role for governments and nonprofits and civil society to try to take down institutions that are hurting women and build up new ones. And so that's all across the board. You know, sometimes tax law makes it less advantageous to have a second earner in a family. And so that's basically saying there's a higher tax rate on women's work than men's work. And so that means women are going to work less, and that's going to change, you know, how much say they have in the family and all sorts of things. Sometimes there are labor restrictions on hours women can work. So I think the, you know, there are laws around maternity leave that can help women or subsidizing childcare so that women can be more supportive, more successful in the labor market. You know, so I think so there's some really nice evidence. So those are all areas where the law is sort of built in with maybe discrimination, maybe not intentional against women. But there are also examples where, you know, governments have been proactive in saying we're going to use our, you know, power as government to try to change these norms. So I think a really powerful example is in India, where there was a constitutional amendment in 1993 that said all of the some of the local government seats are going to be reserved for women. So this was in village councils. And Esther Duflo and co-authors, Esther Duflo is the founder, one of the founders of J-PAL, she and co-authors looked at the effect of this amendment that said, we're going to reserve some seats in local councils and leadership positions for women. And why did the Indian government do that? You know, in some ways, you shouldn't, women's preferences and what they want in policy should be reflected anyway because they vote. But the idea was that, you know, maybe the person who's in power, they're going to, maybe subconsciously, but they're going to do what's the preference of the people similar to them. So if it's mainly men in office. And so these village council leaders, like only one in 20 were women before this constitutional amendment. And then one third had to be women. And what that research has found is that that was very transformational. So first, it meant that when women were local leaders, they supported, they pursued policies that their female constituents valued more. So in other words, you know, men, when they were in power, they did things that helped men. Women, when they were in power, they helped women. And that mattered if women were only 5% of the leaders. And what's, you know, really fascinating about that is that's, you know, that might say, okay, you need to have this quota system forever. But the other studies that the researchers did in it showed that, you know, kind of having women as leaders can have these broader effects. So first, one of the interesting findings is that it started to change stereotypes and misperceptions voters had about women as leaders. So, you know, maybe the reason there were only 5% of women as leaders is because people think, oh, they're not going to be as good, they're not as effective. But when, because of this constitutional amendment, some places had female leaders.
It had to be there.
Yeah, they had to be there, but then they realized, huh, we kind of like having female leaders. You know, they're quite competent. They're, you know, they're very good at their jobs. And so, you know, that's really promising because it suggests that maybe you can do some temporary policy like this, and then you could take it away eventually because people's negative stereotypes are lifted. And, you know, that research, the final thing that I'll mention about that research is it also affected the next generation. You know, you're trying to unlock something. And in this case, when in the villages where, and I should have mentioned that which councils had female leaders randomized. And what the researchers found is if you were randomized twice to have a female leader, so you had like 10 years of female leadership, you started to see that parents' aspirations for their daughters increased. So like they wanted their daughters to pursue education more. And the girls themselves, they started to have higher aspirations. And so, you know, this is really promising because it says that, you know, governments can really unlock some of these big changes with some policies. In this case, it was reserving positions for female leaders, but it started to change, you know, people's attitudes and girls' aspirations in a way that you can imagine it started to change all of these norms that affect many, many different aspects of women's well-being.
Well, wonderful. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Seema. About the laws and regulations, I want to give some short highlights. Well, indeed, it's partly informal norms, partly formal institutions that shapes the gender views and gender norms. But if we talk about government roles, we could say that we are truly familiar with programs such as maternity leave, labor work, subsidized childcare, and other examples where government are proactive. You mentioned in India, they have a constitutional amendment where they reserve some seat to local council for leadership position for women. Even one third have to be women. And it has very transformational output because women, when they empower, they will help not only themselves, but the society around them. And this constitutional amendment also affect how parents have aspirations for daughters in the long term and how women sees themselves. Okay, what can I do in the future, the educations that I will take and so on. Okay, Seema, second, I would like to discuss you about the limitations and program designs that, you know, that we currently facing. Many existing studies offer evidence that social norms related to gender limit the effectiveness of many programs that target women. So therefore, it is important to dig deeper on the design elements and other considerations to make the program. So my question is, Seema, from a comparative perspective, how do you take into account existing gender norms in designing programs or policies? How do you balance between promoting gender equality with designing programs that will receive full support from the community? Your take,
Sima. Yeah, no, I think, you know, sometimes it's the right policy or it's the right moment to try to change those norms directly. And in other cases, if your goal is to reduce child malnutrition or it's to increase education, you know, you it's maybe a distraction to try to do too many things in one policy. So you need to, but what's really important is for governments to and anyone who's designing policy to be very aware of those gender norms and think, how is that gender norm going to help inhibit this program from being effective or help it be more successful? So, you know, in some cases you might say, oh, you know, if there's a norm, we should give this information to the man because he's not going to listen to his wife or something. You know, there have been some studies that show that if you give information campaigns to women, you know, maybe their husbands don't learn as much, but, and I have some research in Uganda that finds this, if you teach women about child nutrition there and you test their husbands, they don't learn. If you teach men and you test their wives, they learn. And it's basically because, you know, maybe the women are listening to their husbands and believing what they tell them more than vice versa. So that's a case where, you know, you have to be realistic about those norms. But I think that, I think even more broadly than that, there are opportunities to improve. If you want to have policies that are directed to women, I think you can often improve how well they work by just seeing it through the lens of these gender norms. So I'll give you an example where, you know, maybe one of the reasons why women are not working as much is because they don't have control over the money once they earn it. So they say, okay, I did all this work, but my husband gets to decide how to spend the money in our bank account. So there's a nice study in India where it was as a government works program. So it was a social safety net program that involved work, NREGA. The one JPAL study tried opening bank accounts for women and then depositing their earnings directly in their own bank account. So rather than their earnings going to their husband's bank account, it went into their bank account. And they saw that it led to an increase in women's employment. And so why does that have to do with the norm? Well, if the norm is the men get to control the money, then you might not be able to, or men get to control the joint bank account, you might not change that norm, but you could say, okay, if that's the norm, we shouldn't be depositing earnings in women's, in the joint bank accounts. We need to open bank accounts just for women.
Yes.
So in some of my own research, we looked at business training. So a lot of women are small micro entrepreneurs. You know, they run a little business. And so many nonprofits and governments and microcredit organizations offer business training to women to try to teach them how to think about profits and losses and improve their business. And what we found is if with that business training, we tweaked it and said, let's let women bring a friend to the training, it was much, much more effective. Yeah. And so there was a norm that women really can't go out and about in society. They can't talk to people. And so if you give them business training, but they, you know, they just don't have a lot of people to talk to, it's not going to be that useful. Yes. But if they can come with a friend and they could talk about that, and, you know, and it'll be much more effective. Yeah. And what we actually found is that one of the reasons it was very valuable to kind of strengthen networks of between women is it made them aim higher, you know, like that when they were only when they didn't have as much social interaction, they weren't ambitious enough. And so by designing a business training that strengthened the networks and peer links between women entrepreneurs, the business training was more successful and it made women more ambitious and more successful.
Okay. Well, if I can wrap it up, thank you so much, Sima. To be aware of the gender norms when designing the programs and to be mindful to think and rethink whether these gender norms will help or inhibit these programs and, you know, how the program is going forward. So lastly, Seema, I would like to discuss with you about ways that we can improve gender awareness, because we all know gender norms are particularly difficult to change because they are considered as normal, pervasive, and are held in place by behaviors, beliefs, and institutions. So raising awareness on gender-related issues must be pursued in households, society, and institutions to challenge and nudge perceived gender norms. So without awareness, we cannot identify the gaps that put barriers on women. So my question is, what are the important features that need to be incorporated in gender awareness educations or campaign works? How do you see the role of men in raising gender-related issues? Your take, Seema.
Yeah, this is a question, and it's an opportunity for me to talk about some of my, you know, very recent research that I'm excited about. So I'm going to kind of answer this question using this example, again, from India, that was aimed at just changing these gender norms and attitudes head on. So it wasn't designing around the norms. It was saying, let's try to change what's in people's hearts about equality. And one of the big lessons from that was how important it is to involve men and boys in changing these gender norms in society. And so this was my research with Devadhar and Tarun Jain was in a state in India, Haryana. And it's one of the kind of worst states in terms of gender equality. One measure of that is the skewed sex ratio. There's a lot of sex selective abortion in India. So in this state, there were only 86 girls born for every 100 boys. And like the rest of India, there's very low female labor force participation. So just about 20% of women are working outside the home. And so we worked with a nonprofit called Breakthrough that works on changing norms around gender. And they designed a curriculum for schools targeting adolescents. And so you can try to change anybody's gender attitudes, but we sort of took the view that, okay, when people are young, that is when a lot of their moral views, their stereotypes are being formed. Yeah. Let's work with that group. And schools are very powerful ways for governments to influence people's values because you have everybody in school. And so Breakthrough, the government was very interested in doing this. They don't want a skewed sex ratio. They don't want only 20% of women working. So they said, okay, you know, as a pilot, we don't want to design it. We don't want to run it ourselves. So we'll let Breakthrough design it. And then they can run this program in school, like during the regular school day. They can kind of come in and take over the classroom once every 2-3 weeks. And this program ran for 2.5 years. And its goal was to kind of raise awareness about gender discrimination, but also just to, for fundamentally, it was aiming to make the boys and girls think it's not right for boys to get more opportunities to go to college than for girls to. It's not right for women not to be able to work outside the home. It's not right to care more about your sons than your daughters. Yeah. So it was really trying to change people's attitudes, where the hope was that would in turn make them behave in ways more that were more equal. And, you know, girls would sort of see, okay, I'm going to live in a more fair world, and it would raise their aspirations. So next slide, please. I don't know who's operating the slides. So thank you. What we studied in this research was kind of people's attitudes, both boys and girls. And then we looked at, just for girls, their aspirations, like did they want to have a career and they aspire to go to college? And then we looked for behaviors that were kind of governed by these norms, like things, you know, did boys help out with chores in the household, since that's something that you know is not very common. And I should say, you know, this intervention was like very much trying to get kids involved, think about their own lives, and, you know, hopefully put it into practice. So the next slide, please. I'm very excited to say that this program had a really big effect on people's attitudes. You know, a lot fewer times they thought it was okay to discriminate against women. And we see that it translated into behavior that was more consistent with believing in equality. And that's where this point about involving boys and men is important, because we saw that behavior change was easier for boys and girls. And so first, just in terms of the attitudes, we saw that, you know, the program converted 16%, or about one in six cases where someone initially was holding a regressive, stereotyped view, it converted them to having more support for gender equality. So it didn't solve all of the problem, but honestly, we shouldn't be hoping any intervention is going to solve such a big problem and, you know, change people's attitudes altogether. So I think of 16% as a pretty big dent in the problem. And then it led to more gender equitable behavior. And across the board, it was more for boys than girls. And, you know, that's interesting because both had better attitudes. But, you know, it's almost the very nature of boys' power in society is that, you know, they believed in it and they had the power to act on it without fearing for, you know, penalties from their family. Whereas girls, they changed their attitudes, but they probably still felt some constraints on acting in the way they believed. And so, you know, maybe for a bad reason, we really need to involve boys and men's. And the program didn't affect girls' aspirations that were, they were pretty high to begin with. So the most amazing thing to me is that this was a 2.5 year program. We saw these big effects right after the program had ended when the kids were about 15 years old. We went and resurveyed them two and a half years later, and we see that this really stuck. They still, the kids who were in the treatment group or were exposed to this curriculum, they still believed more in equality. And so, you know, our next question is going to be, are there even longer term impacts? Do we see the women are more likely to work? Do we see that the boys who are in the program, are they more accepting of their wives working when they get married and they have wives? And so it'll be very exciting to see if, you know, by changing what was in adolescents, you know, hearts and minds, it changed the way they act as young adults. And then when they raise families, you know, the way they raise their kids. And, you know, most exciting for us is that one of the states in India has decided, based on this evidence, has decided to try this at a much larger scale with 600,000 students per year kind of rolled out statewide, you know, just under the view that it doesn't cost a lot because you're just doing it in the regular school day. But what you get is, you know, a next generation that believes more in gender equality. So I'm very excited about this as a, you know, an approach that can be used in many contexts, including Indonesia, to try to bring about these better gender norms.
Well, yeah, thank you very much, Seema, for such elaborative insights and wonderful examples that you provided on programs that promote gender norms and equality. Well, how important it is to involve men, well, everyone's voice in changing gender norms in the society. In an example that you mentioned before, there's even a school curriculum where since young, it is being aimed to change gender attitudes, behaviors, and girls' aspirations, which are being projected to not only girls, but also boys since very, very young. So many attempts have been done to achieve an equal gender views and gender equality, formally, informally, starting early, applied at the society level, and also from laws and regulations. And importantly, all the stakeholders has to work together collectively with their each roles. Thank you very much again, Seema. We'll talk with you further at the Q&A session. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let us now speak with Ibu Dr. Randa Leni Rosalin. As a way of introduction, Dr. Randa Leni Rosalin serves as the Deputy of Gender Equality at the Ministry of Women Empowerment and Child Protections of the Republic of Indonesia. And before joining the current ministry, she served as Head of Women Empowerment Subdirectorate at the Ministry of National Development Planning, or BAPENAS, from 2001 and 2007, and has been extensively involved in gender mainstreaming in national development planning for over 20 years. Without further ado, let me invite Dr. Randa Leni Rosalin to join us on the stage. Selamat pagi, Ibu. Selamat pagi, Ibu Leni.
Selamat pagi, tapi saya kok nggak bisa start video ya? Ah, oke.
Can someone from the committee help Ibu Leni to start the video?
Halo Ibu, saya ask to start video. Apakah
ada saya udah ini? Tapi nggak bisa terus tulisannya. Start my video sudah. Tapi begitu di enter, di start videonya nggak keluar.
Di saya ada ibu untuk start letter.
Ya.
Ya, saya coba lagi.
Yes.
Nah, ibu, ya ibu, ibu kliknya start start ibu, jangan start letter. Mohon izin. Silakan.
Ya, saya udah klik start video tapi nggak bisa keluar. Nggak mau tuh, kayak di lock dari sana gitu Mbak.
Dari kami sudah dibuka Ibu dan sudah start. Dicoba lagi Ibu.
Keluar lagi aja ya, kayaknya tadi udah bisa tapi barusan. Tadi waktu saya join pertama kali bisa. Ini nggak bisa start videonya keluar.
Ya, Ibu sudah saya jadikan ke host. Boleh dicoba lagi, Ibu?
Oh ya, kenapa ya?
Apa kita rejoin lagi aja?
Saya keluar dulu deh ya. Saya join lagi ya. Kayaknya nggak tahu deh kenapa ini.
Ibu nggak bisa buka kamera itu gimana ya?
Bentar.
Okay, we are still waiting for Ibu Dr. Andelini Rosalin to activate the video, and the committee has been currently doing its best to, for Ibu Leni Rosalin to start the video. Ibu, is everything good? Anything that I could help?
Okay. Is that okay now? Yeah. I have to quit. Bu Ade, do I have to speak in Bahasa or in English?
Okay, now all good. Ibu Leni, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ibu Leni, kita
berbicara
bahasa Indonesia.
Okay.
Mohon diganti interpretation yang ada di kolom kanan, interpretation dalam bahasa Japanese. Jadi Ibu Leni bisa klik ke kolom interpretation dan select opsi bahasa Japanese, karena memang Japanese ini dalam dalam sesi ini kita akan berbicara dalam bahasa Indonesia. Oke, baik. Ibu Leni, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, Ibu.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Bu Ade.
Ibu telah bergabung bersama kami di acara pada pagi hari ini. Ibu, sebelum pemaparan dari Ibu Leni, sebelumnya saya juga akan bertanya kepada Ibu Leni tentang laws dan institusi dan hukum dalam membentuk gender norma, norma-norma gender yang ada terutama di Indonesia. Tadi di perbincangan pertama, Mas, gender norms atau norma gender yang ada, dan ini sudah harus dimulai sedari kecil. Bahkan seperti contoh kasus di Indonesia, ada beberapa kurikulum yang memang exposing mereka untuk mengerti bahwa ini loh aspirasi yang dimiliki oleh perempuan sama seperti yang dimiliki oleh laki-laki. Dan ini sudah ditanamkan dari kecil. Dan juga banyak sekali ada contoh-contoh seperti constitutional amendment bahwa satu dari tiga orang yang ada di government itu harus perempuan. Nah, pertanyaan saya, di Indonesia, bagaimana Anda melihat hubungan antara peraturan yang ada di Indonesia saat ini dengan norma-norma gender serta ketidaksetaraan gender yang ada? Apakah ada gagasan Anda untuk mengatasi permasalahan masih adanya norma gender yang membatasi perempuan di Indonesia? Dan bagaimana Anda menjaga kebijakan tetap relevan di tengah lingkungan dan pelaku kebijakan yang tentunya terus berubah? Silakan Ibu.
Iya, terima kasih Bu Ade. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat siang, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Salam sehat, terima kasih. Saya baru terima pertanyaan dari Cepal itu pagi tadi ya. Jadi untuk menyiapkan materi. Jadi dari sisi regulasi, saya akan urutkan ya, karena sebetulnya saya juga menangani hal ini pada waktu saya masih di Bappenas ya. 22 tahun lebih saya di Bappenas dan juga turut mengawal beberapa regulasi sampai kemudian saya juga menangani bidang-bidang lainnya, dan baru per 1 April tahun ini saya sebagai deputi bidang kesetaraan gender. Jadi dalam tempo yang masih sekitar 5 bulan ini kami menata semuanya dan mempunyai inovasi-inovasi yang nanti saya akan sharing. Ya, makasih. Kita punya, Indonesia punya penduduk 270 juta, perempuan itu hampir separuhnya, ya. Anak sekitar sepertiganya, jadi kalau perempuan dan anak itu dijumlahkan, itu sekitar 2/3 dari total penduduk. Untuk regulasi sebenarnya sudah sangat banyak sekali. Sebetulnya waktu kita bicara konstitusi Undang-Undang Dasar 1940, ya, yang pertama kan preventing discrimination against women, atau konvensi penghapusan segala bentuk tindak kekerasan, segala bentuk diskriminasi terhadap perempuan. Itu dalam bentuk undang-undang. Belum lagi yang tentang bagaimana kita menghapus KDRT, kekerasan dalam rumah tangga, memberantas tindak pidana perdagangan orang. Yang sebagian besar ini adalah korban-korbannya adalah perempuan. Jadi itu semua dengan undang-undang. Kemudian untuk anak, kita juga bicara tentang undang-undang perlindungan anak. Ya. Jadi kemarin saya sempat sekitar 7 tahun ya, saya di Deputi Menteri Bidang Tumbuh Kembang Anak dan Pemenuhan Hak Anak, ya, itu membahas berbagai hal di sana dan melakukan aksi-aksi real, termasuk bagaimana kita menanamkan nilai-nilai kepada anak-anak kita dari sejak kecil. Jadi khusus anak ini, sebetulnya pemerintah sudah banyak melakukan hal yang positif, menanamkan value kepada anak-anak kita, kita membentuk forum anak, kita memberdayakan, melatih, mengadvokasi, mendampingi anak-anak kita, sehingga anak-anak kita perankan sebagai pelopor dan pelapor, dan itu ada mulai dari tingkat nasional sampai tingkat desa, ada namanya forum anak, ya, jadi bisa dibuka di dalam website, apa aktivitas mereka, apa yang menjadi concern mereka di seluruh Indonesia. Undang-undang perkawinan juga kita revisi, kebetulan saya yang leading proses revisi undang-undang tersebut, menjadi Undang-Undang nomor 16 tahun 2019 yang menaikkan usia perkawinan dari yang semula anak perempuan adalah 16 tahun menjadi 19 tahun. Jadi ini tujuannya adalah tidak hanya demi kesehatan, tetapi juga untuk kita bisa mensukseskan wajib belajar 12 tahun. Dan juga tentunya mengurangi kemiskinan dan juga dalam rangka untuk mengamankan indeks-indeks pembangunan manusia kita yang tentunya itu sangat berkaitan dengan peristiwa kalau misalnya terjadi perkawinan anak, ya, karena kerugian yang terjadi itu multiplier. Nah, kita juga meratifikasi konvensi hak anak tahun 1990. Kemudian dari sisi peraturan-peraturan kita juga banyak, kita untuk SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, itu juga ada untuk rencana pembangunan jangka menengah yang saat ini sudah ada. Nah, ada Impres khusus nomor 9 tahun 2000, tahun 2000, yaitu tentang pengaruh utamaan gender dalam pembangunan nasional, ya. Dan kita mulai tahun kemarin itu kita fokus pada pembangunan desa, menggarap semua isu perempuan, isu gender, isu anak di tingkat desa. Nanti saya jelaskan secara detail. Dan di dalam undang-undang pemerintahan desa juga tertuang secara eksplisit tentang gender ini. Jadi Bu Bapak sekalian, Mbak Adik, ya, kompleks ya. Ini kalau mau dilihat di sini semuanya ada sebetulnya regulasinya cukup lengkap lah. Tetapi data menunjukkan masih banyak nih kesenjangan gender, ya. Kesenjangan gender yang ada kalau tadi Ibu siapa pembicara yang sebelumnya menyampaikan tentang bentuk-bentuk bentuk-bentuk diskriminasi gender, apakah di stereotype, marginalisasi, subordinasi, beban ganda, violence, semua dialami perempuan, baik itu di rumah, di ruang publik, di tempat kerja, ya kan? Nah, jadi ini challenge-nya. Nah, coba kita lihat dari indikator-indikatornya. Nah, saya begitu saya menjadi deputi di sini, saya langsung melakukan pengolahan data, karena kebetulan saya juga latar belakangnya juga dosen, ya, dan statistik, jadi saya melakukan pengolahan data, dan dari 11 tahun terakhir data ini kita melihat bahwa indeks pembangunan manusia Indonesia memang meningkat, ya, dari tahun ke tahun. Tetapi kalau dilihat dari grafik ini, kesenjangan gendernya itu masih tetap sama, ya. Jadi kalau dilihat garis ini, garis yang paling atas ini indeks pembangunan manusia laki-laki, yang paling bawah itu yang perempuan. Nah, kesenjangan gender antara yang paling atas dengan yang paling bawah, kalau kita lihat kan gapnya hampir sama nih, ya, selama 11 tahun. Jadi artinya apa? Artinya pendidikan, kesehatan, ekonomi perempuan maupun laki-laki meningkat, tetapi kesenjangan gender tidak mengalami perubahan. Ya, kalau dilihat per provinsi, hanya 11 provinsi yang di atas angka nasional. Sebagian besar masih angkanya di bawah angka rata-rata nasional. Sekarang gender indeks pembangunan gender, ya, yang kita hitung sama dengan IPM, tapi dia melihat rasio indeks IPM-nya laki dan perempuan. 11 tahun hanya naik 0,6 poin. Ternyata salah satu faktor yang terbesar penyebab gap-nya adalah ekonomi. Ya. Nah, kalau dilihat antar provinsi, juga hanya 15 provinsi yang di atas angka nasional. Ya. Terus indeks yang ketiga, indeks pemberdayaan gender. Ini mengukur peran perempuan di politik, ya, profesional perempuan, dan juga ekonomi. Balik lagi ekonomi lagi. Jadi dari tiga indeks yang saya sebutkan, ini semua ada ekonominya. Nah, kalau dilihat di sini, angkanya meningkat, tapi di 2019 memang cukup signifikan karena ini keterwakilan perempuan di parlemen yang mendukung peningkatan ini. Ya, tapi sebelumnya itu masih tetap rendah. Nah, kalau dilihat lagi indikator yang berikutnya, partisipasi angkatan kerja. Ya, kalau kita lihat di sini, warna biru itu adalah miliknya laki-laki. Warna hijau ini miliknya perempuan. Kita lihat di sini, semua angka perempuan jauh tertinggal dari laki-laki dan gap-nya juga sangat tinggi. Ya, jadi sekitar 30 poin. Pekerja di Indonesia didominasi laki-laki. Tadi TPAK setiap tahun juga tertinggi laki-laki. Status pekerjaan utama, perempuan banyak bekerja di pekerjaan keluarga yang tidak berbayar. Ya. Jadi ini, terus kemudian di posisi manajerial, perempuan hanya, maksudnya masih tertinggal dari laki-laki. Sektor informal kita terbanyak yang perempuan. Ya. Kemudian dalam upah pun juga terjadi a gender wage gap antara laki-laki dan perempuan, ya. Pengangguran terbuka tertinggi juga perempuan. Kalau dilihat dari keterwakilan perempuan di politik, nah ini yang tadi ya, ini juga angkanya juga yang pink itu kan yang perempuan, yang hijau yang laki, sangat jomplang sekali ya. Ya, keterwakilan di DPD juga hanya antara 30% berbanding 70%, di DPR hanya 17,5% berbanding 82%. Nah, jadi regulasinya sudah ada, dilakukannya oleh seluruh kementerian lembaga, dunia usaha, lembaga masyarakat, perguruan tinggi, semua stakeholders turut serta di sana membangun manusia Indonesia, tidak terkecuali laki dan perempuan. Ya, jadi Bapak Presiden kemudian memberikan arahan khusus untuk 2020-2024 ini, yaitu 5, karena melihat berbagai data tadi, ya, 5 arahan tersebut, yaitu pemberdayaan perempuan di kewirausahaan ini untuk menembak isu ekonominya, kemudian yang kedua untuk parentingnya. Jadi kalau kita bicara parenting di sini nanti multiplier impactnya kemana-mana ya. Kemudian yang ketiga to reduce violence against women and children, kemudian child labor sama child marriage. Nah, ini data-data pick up-nya mengapa 5 isu itu menjadi isu yang penting. Contoh violence. Violence itu 1 dari 3 perempuan di Indonesia, survei nasional kita. Ini 2016, ini yang terbaru sedang ongoing. Ya. Nah, itu 1 dari 3 perempuan pernah mengalami kekerasan. Kalau anak, 2 dari 3 anak pernah mengalami kekerasan. Ya. Untuk pekerja anak, hampir 10% anak-anak kita masih bekerja. How come? Mereka harusnya akan bersekolah. Ya, padahal pemerintah menyediakan dana pendidikan gratis, ya, dan pemerintah mentargetkan wajib belajar 12 tahun. Tapi kita lihat, anak di sini adalah usia di bawah 18 tahun, jadi sampai SMA, ya. Nah, hampir 10%. Jadi, gimana kita mau bicara kualitas di sini, ya? Ini potretnya antar provinsi juga masih banyak yang merah. Nah, child marriage, 1 dari 9 anak kita masih kawin di bawah usia anak. Jadi kalau dilihat di angka provinsinya juga banyak yang merah. Nah, ini dampak perkawinan anak. Ini yang juga kami garap dengan anak-anak ya, terutama anak-anak SD, SMP, SMA. Jadi agar mereka punya perspektif norms tadi ya, value yang mereka pahami dari sejak mereka kecil. Dan ini kita kerjakan bersama-sama dengan forum anak. Sekali lagi forum anak kita memiliki di seluruh provinsi, seluruh kabupaten, hampir sebagian besar ya, sekitar 458 kabupaten kota, ribuan kecamatan dan ribuan desa kelurahan. Jadi udah puluhan juta anak-anak Indonesia bergabung di dalam forum anak. dan mereka juga memilih salah satu yang topik mereka garap adalah tentang child marriage ini. Karena mereka sadar betul dampak dari child marriage ini. Kesehatan dampaknya. Ya, jadi ibu punya, ibunya masih anak-anak. Dia melahirkan anak-anak. Jadi anak punya anak masih anak. Risiko terburuknya maternal mortality rate. Ya, bagi anak risiko terburuk infant mortality rate. Gizi, stunting, wasting, ya, gizi buruk semuanya itu sebagai penyebab karena ibu-ibunya yang punya anak tadi adalah masih usia anak. Nice. Mereka pasti drop out dari sekolah. Jadi wajib belajar terancam. Sementara karena dia harus menghidupi keluarga, dia harus bekerja. Muncul isu baru, pekerja anak. Ya, lulus hanya SD, upah pasti rendah. Ya, bekerja di sektor informal, mengkreat kemiskinan. Kesehatan, pendidikan, ekonomi ini adalah yang digunakan untuk mengukur indeks pembangunan manusia kita.
Baik.
Ada banyak sekali SDGs goals yang akan terancam tidak tercapai, yaitu misalnya di sini saya identifikasi ada 8 goals, ya 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8, 10, 16. Belum isu lainnya, karena ini anak masih punya anak. Ya. Nah, sementara target-target ditetapkan oleh pemerintah, indeks pembangunan gender harus dinaikkan, ya. Indeks pemberdayaan gender harus dinaikkan. Ini angka sampai target 2024 ya, yang tertuang di dalam peraturan presiden. Tingkat partisipasi angkatan kerja juga harus dinaikkan. Angka kematian ibu harus diturunkan. Angka kematian bayi harus diturunkan. Stunting harus diturunkan menjadi separohnya. Wasting juga harus diturunkan menjadi 7%.
Baik.
Nah, pertanyaannya, why gender terjadi? Itu kan kesenjangan gender terjadi. Itu kan? Nah, jadi kalau disamerikan, diringkaskan, sebetulnya dari sisi regulasi tadi sudah banyak sekali. Berarti pertanyaannya adalah kenapa kesenjangan gender masih ada dan masih banyak terjadi. Kita harus melihat di tingkat implementasinya. Ya. Data kuantitatif tidak cukup untuk menjawab itu. Harus disertai dengan data kualitatif. Penelitian yang sangat berbasis evidence sangat penting sekali. Ya. Jadi, apa namanya, melihat sampai ke tingkat individu maupun di tingkat keluarga maupun di tingkat komunitas. Ya. Jadi itu beberapa hal. Dan kalau kita lihat analisis yang Indonesia lakukan, kebetulan saya adalah yang menyusun di Bappenas yang disebut dengan itu menjadi alat analisis yang ketiga di dunia karena sudah ada dua sebelumnya. Ya. Nah, jadi alat yang bisa diterima oleh perempuan dan sejauh mana perempuan bisa memperoleh benefits-nya tadi. Dan inilah yang kita lakukan bersama-sama dengan kementerian lembaga dan pemerintah daerah. Dan memang dimulainya tahapannya adalah dari tahap perencanaan dan penganggaran. Jadi sebetulnya kita sudah cukup maju untuk prosesnya. Hanya saja memang mungkin karena Indonesia ini sangat besar sekali dan sektor pembangunan kita juga sangat banyak sekali dan juga complicated juga ya. Jadi isu-isu yang kita tackle itu sebetulnya kami juga membatasi ya akhirnya ya karena dengan banyaknya isu tersebut. Tapi intinya kita mengajak NGO. Saya ingin menyampaikan sedikit di sini bagaimana 5 arahan Bapak Presiden tadi dijabarkan implementasinya ya Mbak Ade ya.
Jadi, ya silakan Ibu.
Jadi dari 5 arahan Bapak Presiden, kita membuat analisis yang sangat sederhana ya, karena ini kita terapkan di tingkat desa ya. Jadi sejak November 2020 ini ya, November 2020 kita bersama-sama dengan Kementerian Desa mengembangkan Desa Ramah Perempuan dan Peduli Anak. Itu untuk menjabarkan 5 arahan Bapak Presiden yang tadi sudah saya sebutkan ke dalam analisis yang sederhana yang harus dimulai di tingkat desa dan kita harus tahu masyarakat kita di desa masih banyak yang pendidikannya rendah sehingga kita pakai bahasa yang sederhana ya.
Baik.
Jadi entry point-nya lewat ekonomi ya, entry point lewat ekonomi dan itu kita awal dari sebelum kita bicara ekonomi di sini tentunya prasyaratnya adalah kita meningkatkan pemahaman kritis ya, kesadaran kritis dari para perempuan. Jadi kita melakukan pelatihan leadership bagi para perempuan perdesaan. Kita sudah mencakup di beberapa provinsi ya. Jadi seperti kemarin juga saya baru saja menutup pelatihan kepemimpinan perempuan perdesaan kita latih mereka agar mereka memiliki kesadaran kritis yang tinggi dan kemudian mereka bisa melakukan langkah-langkah berikutnya. Nah, salah satu intervensi yang sesuai arahan Bapak Presiden adalah kita mengintervensi lewat ekonomi. Harapannya kita ingin mencetak para perempuan yang punya kesadaran kritis tadi ya untuk bisa salah satunya berperan di ekonomi. Karena tadi indeks-indeks tadi kan potretnya yang buruk perempuan dari sisi ekonominya, ya. Nah, jadi ekonomi menjadi entry point. Harapannya nanti income keluarga bisa meningkat dan ini bisa berkontribusi pada kasus-kasus yang lainnya untuk bisa ditekan.
Baik, apakah mohon maaf, waktunya kita satu menit lagi, Bu, untuk ya. Pemaparannya.
Jadi kita ini ya, ini rasionalnya saja, ya, rasional melakukan itu. Nah, jadi kita juga bersama-sama Kementerian Desa untuk SDGs desa yang kelima itu kita integrasikan ke dalam proses sustainable Baik. Development goals.
Sudah ada di sustainable
ini. Ya. Nah, kalau kita lihat di desa indikatornya. Ini ada pengorganisasian perempuan dan anak di desa, ya coba share. Ya, jadi data peraturan desa, financing, ya. Terus kemudian keterwakilan perempuan. Nah, ini leadership critical awareness dari perempuan desa kita bangun sehingga kita dorong mereka, mereka kita latih, kita dampingi, kita punya pendamping desa ya, kita dampingi sehingga harapannya mereka nanti bisa duduk di apakah pemerintah desa ataukah badan pemberdayaan badan permusyawaratan desa atau lembaga masyarakat desa, lembaga adat desa ya, you name it deh, apa yang ada di sana itu kita, dan ini sudah apa namanya sudah berjalan di tahun kedua. Ya, sementara lima arahan Bapak Presiden tadi itu di skema yang paling kanan. Jadi ini bagaimana kita membangunnya di tingkat desa ya, karena kita punya wilayah segini banyak nih, 74.961, tapi kita sudah lakukan sampel di beberapa daerah. Dan ini kita integrasikan desa-desa ini dengan sistem-sistem pembangunan desa lainnya, ya. Jadi, nah satu inovasi yang sekarang kami sedang garap. Ini mungkin perlu diketahui oleh semuanya.
Baik, Ibu, jadi mohon maaf waktunya sudah habis. Apakah bisa dilanjutkan ke Q&A session, Ibu, untuk pemaparannya?
Boleh, boleh. Karena ini sudah sebetulnya poin saya yang sedang ongoing nih, ya. Jadi yang menjadi entry point untuk masuknya intervensi gender mainstreaming, yaitu kita punya ruang setara yang ini sebentar lagi nanti di hari Ibu akan kita launching. Putaran. Jadi putaran pusat pembelajaran perempuan menjadi wadah bagaimana perempuan bisa menyuarakan dan menjadi agen perubahan, terus kita lengkapi dengan prisma pusat informasi. Dan untuk putaran itu sendiri ada 6 ya, yang kita siapkan. Ekonomi, sehat, pintar, hukum, politik, dan lestari. Minimal 6 ini
Ibu,
bisa jalan.
Baik Ibu Leni Rosan, ya? Terima kasih banyak untuk pemaparannya. Nanti kita akan lanjutkan kembali ya. Untuk program-programnya lebih detail lagi di Q&A session. Mengingat banyak sekali pertanyaan juga yang sudah diajukan oleh para audiens, terutama kepada Ibu Leni. Mohon maaf sekali Bu, saya harus memotongnya karena keterbatasan waktu. Itu tanda dari pemaparan dari komitmen dan pemenuhan hak-hak dasar perempuan yang tertuang dengan komprehensif di undang-undang dan beberapa data-data serta indeks-indeks substansif tentang keadaan dan normal terkait gender di Indonesia. Dan tadi juga Ibu Leni juga memaparkan 5 arah dari Presiden Republik Indonesia dalam menuju kesetaraan gender di Indonesia, di mana entry point-nya melalui ekonomi, yaitu kewirausahaan, peningkatan peran ibu dan keluarga dalam child care, penurunan kekerasan pada perempuan, penurunan pekerja anak, dan pencegahan perkawinan anak. Dan mengingat waktu yang sangat terbatas, kita hanya langsung memasuki Q&A session kita pada pagi hari ini. Thank you Sima, thank you Ibu Leni for the insightful session today. Next for the Q&A session, we have received a lot of questions. We apologize that due to time constraint, we will only be able to choose a limited number of questions. The first question is for Professor Sima. It's from Tria Lakshmi from Bihar. The first question. There is no doubt that one of the ways to improve attitude requires behavior change communication, Sima. How do you see the roles of CSOs and DPOs in promoting gender equality, women empowerment, and social inclusion? Thank you so much. Your take, Sima.
Yeah, I think this is it's an all hands on deck problem. So I think that there are certain things like law changes where it will ultimately be the government, but a lot of the policies to support, to provide, you know, training to women for, say, leadership training, to have more women be successful in business, or to change attitudes in the way I was talking yeah. about. There's a very large role for kind of all players in development and the social sector to be innovating and pursuing these policies. So I'm, you know, would love to encourage kind of all everybody to be innovating and trying to solve this multifaceted problem.
Well, yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much for such blunt and comprehensive answers towards the question, Sima. Thank you very much. We will now moving on further to Ibu Dr. Andal ini. Ini ada pertanyaan dari Dr. Andal Nenyanti kepada Ibu Leni. Apakah saya dapat mengakses data dan PowerPoint ini? Karena begitu banyak data yang saya ingin ambil dari presentasi tersebut. Dan pertanyaan saya, jika data sudah ada, Ibu, proyeksi kegiatan dan program 5 tahun ke depan itu seperti apa? Oh iya, Bu. Yang Femokrat atau Feminist Demokrat or Feminist Burokrat, what are the future actions? Apa aksi-aksi ke depannya yang sudah dilakukan oleh pemerintah? Mengingat birokrat yang feminis belum banyak, dan bagaimana pemerintah encouraging mereka untuk berkarya? Terima kasih. Silakan Ibu Neng.
Terima kasih Ibu Neng Yanti ya.
Iya betul.
Apa namanya? Jadi saya akan menekankan di sini bahwa sebetulnya untuk datanya oke, nanti PowerPoint saya silakan diakses.
Baik. Ya.
Dan target-target untuk 5 tahun ke depan itu memang kita fokuskan pada beberapa bidang yang tujuannya adalah untuk bisa mengangkat performance Indonesia di mata dunia. Ya, jadi kalau tadi saya sampaikan angka-angka indeks tersebut, itu fokus utamanya kan akhirnya kan pendidikan, kesehatan, ekonomi, dan politics. Artinya politics di sini leadership, ya, kepemimpinan perempuan. Jadi kita memang melakukan training-training kepada para perempuan, terutama agar kita dorong mereka agar bisa menjadi female leaders gitu ya. Nah ini sangat penting, dan memang belum banyak, justru itulah akhirnya potret kita kurang baik gitu kan. Nah jadi apa aksi kedepannya ya, aksi kedepannya pelatihan-pelatihan akan diperbanyak, dan Indonesia karena tahun ini dan tahun depan ya menjadi ketua untuk G20, presidensi Indonesia ya, G20. Nah, Kementerian Pemberdayaan Perempuan dan Perlindungan Anak menjadi mother ministry untuk engagement W20 dan G20 empower ya. Jadi yang diangkat di dalam isu untuk ditangani di dalam W20 itu juga banyak sekali, termasuk bagaimana kita mengangkat para perempuan ini. Bahkan untuk G20 Empower, itu public-private partnership-nya, itu teman-teman di swasta memiliki target-target yang sangat spesifik untuk meningkatkan posisi perempuan sebagai leaders di perusahaannya. Ya. Dan ini sebetulnya sangat inline dengan target-target yang ada di dalam Sustainable Development Goals juga. Jadi sebetulnya ini bisa kita mulai dari institusi. Misalnya sekarang Ibu ada di S2 ya, di S2 universitasnya di mana nih, nggak tahu ya. Nah, S2 kajian di UI dan S3 di public, S2 di UI. Jadi bagaimana di UI misalnya dimulai juga gitu kan, bikin pelatihan-pelatihan sehingga di dalam di dosen-dosen di sana, kemudian disiapkan juga infrastruktur bagi para perempuan, apakah itu childcare ataukah nursery room ya. Sehingga itu juga turut membantu, karena tidak mungkin kalau harus pemerintah semua gitu ya. Jadi affirmative action sangat dibutuhkan, apakah itu dalam bentuk policy ataukah dalam bentuk program yang women specific, karena itu penting. Dan untuk mencegah, jangan sampai perempuan drop out karena dia bingung, aduh nanti saya udah punya anak, anak saya titipin di mana ya, saya mau nyusuin anaknya ya, di kampus nggak ada ruang menyusui nih, di sana nggak ada tempat penitipan anak. Nah, akhirnya dia memutuskan untuk drop out dari sana. Nah, ini hal-hal yang penting ya. Jadi, saya rasa kita perlu bergandengan tangan semua pihak, dan ayo kita bisa memulai dari institusi di mana kita berada juga. Itu mungkin kalau program banyak sekali ya, karena baik, kita baik. Sendiri juga bermitra dengan kementerian lembaga ya, misalnya ya. Perguruan tinggi di bawah Kementerian Pendidikan kan ya. Nah, jadi kita banyak sekali.
Baik, terima kasih banyak Ibu Leni Rosalin tadi menjawab pertanyaan dari Ibu Neng Yati. Terima kasih Ibu, jadi untuk wrap up-nya adalah affirmative action sangat dibutuhkan, dan yang involved itu tidak hanya government, tapi juga swasta, society, semua pihak, semua masyarakat, untuk menciptakan society yang sangat inklusif, women oriented, dan mindful dengan kebutuhan perempuan. Kalau memang harus ada female bureaucrats dan mereka untuk berkarya di bidang-bidangnya masing-masing, bagaimana kita mulai dari bagaimana mereka belajar gitu. Tadi disediakan fasilitas-fasilitas yang mendukung perempuan untuk tetap dapat belajar tanpa memperhatikan, tanpa tidak harus memusingkan bagaimana dia menitipkan anaknya dan lain-lain. Jadi memang semua affirmative action dibutuhkan, tidak hanya dari pemerintah tapi juga swasta, semua terlibat, semua melihat bahwa ini adalah dunia yang dimiliki tidak hanya laki-laki tetapi juga perempuan. Bergandengan tangan semua pihak secara collective. Once again, thank you very much to our distinguished parents, distinguished panelists, Ibu Leni Rosalin and your time, for your insightful perspectives on the topic at hand. We really hope the conversation that took place were thought-provoking and enlightening for everyone in attendance this evening. Untuk Ibu Dr. Randa Leni Rosalin, kami mohon maaf sekali lagi atas keterbatasan waktu dan tidak memaparkan seluruh paparan dengan komprehensif. Maka dari itu, siapapun yang ingin mengakses data dan presentasi yang telah dipaparkan oleh Ibu Leni Rosalin dapat langsung menghubungi komite atau panitia dari JPL Saudi Asia dan akan langsung dikirimkan oleh panitia ke email masing-masing attendance yang membutuhkan. Terima kasih banyak Ibu Leni, terima kasih banyak Ibu Profesor Sima for your attendance this morning. And with this, we are nearing the end of the event. We would now would like to invite Ibu Rina Mardiani to take the stage and deliver the closing remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, Ibu Rina Mardiani.
Thank you, Ade. So good morning and good evening to all of us, our speakers and participants who have joined the webinar from around the world. Greetings to Ibu Leni Rosalin, the Deputy of Gender Equality of the Ministry of Women, Empowerment and Child Protection of the Republic Indonesia. Thank you so much, Ibu, for being here today and sharing our valuable your valuable insight on Indonesian policy and strategies in supporting the gender equality. We are also like very honored to have you here in the conversation with Professor Sima Jayachandra, the Chair of JPL Gender Sector and Professor of Economic of the Northwestern University. So greeting as well to Ms. Jennifer Donoho, the Acting Counselor, Development Effectiveness and Sustainability Section of the Australian Charles de Fair to Indonesia. Thank you so much for your wonderful and insightful welcoming remarks to start our webinar today. So thank you also to Mbak Ade Nurul Safrina, who has been expertly moderating today's session. Thank you as well to all the participants who have joined our webinar today. So as women and girls to continue in face like multiple barriers in fulfilling their rights and seizing the opportunity, we acknowledge the importance of having rigorous evidence in determining the right policy to effectively narrow the gender gap. So we have heard valuable insight directly from Ibu Leni and the learnings from program in other countries by Professor Sima. So not only this, the webinar also like facilitate the like some question from the participants to see the opportunity of the further research to promote gender equality in Indonesia. So in many countries, including Indonesia, narrowing the gender gap is still a challenge task, since the role of women and girls are reinforced through both like formal and informal institution and shaped by long held like social norms toward gender. So we have heard earlier insight on Indonesian strategy and efforts in addressing the gender inequality through the regulatory like frameworks. So more importantly, we have delved into how to best address gender norms on delivering effective programs that target women, as well as lessons from programs in other countries that may be applicable in the context of Indonesia. So this insight is a big reminder for us that we should dig deeper in designing the elements and take careful consideration before making like the program intervention. We also like discuss like how to raise and improve awareness toward gender related issue. So this is like interesting on gender, as gender norms can indeed change, although they may seem intractable. So the discussion today present like lesson for paving the way towards gender equality, as we have been presented with successful program from other countries. I hope this can inspire like all of us and provide inputs to the government of Indonesia to design impactful program that can continue to promote gender equality in Indonesia. Once again, thank you so much for our speaker. Thank you as well for taking the time to join our webinar. So hopefully we can see you again in our next webinar. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Ibu Lina Mariani. And as we have finally come to the end of this event, once again, we'd like to thank our distinguished panelists, Ibu Leni Rosalin and Sima Jayachandran for the discussions, Ibu Lina Mariani and Ibu Jennifer Donohoe for delivering the opening and closing remarks. We would also like to express our deepest gratitude to all the participants for your attendance and enthusiasm this morning. And before we end this event, we would greatly appreciate if you could give us your feedback on today's event. You may access the link to the survey feedback form once you leave this Zoom meeting. And due to the time limitation, we would also like to express our regret as we could only select very few questions from the participants. And if you want to know more about JPL Southeast Asia, you may visit our website at www.povertyactionlab.org/SEA. Today's webinar was recorded and will be later uploaded to our official social media account. Thank you very much once again for your participation and attention. We would like to apologize for any inconvenience that might have occurred during this webinar. I am hoping that we can meet again on another occasion. I am Adisa Frina Nasution, and it has been a pleasure to host this event this morning. Thank you and have a good rest of the day. Bye-bye.